Please be seated. I'm going to start with a story that I have told before, so my apologies, but I kind of like it. It's a story of a taxi passenger who was driving in this cab and had a question to ask the cab driver, so he tapped him on the shoulder. Well, the driver suddenly screamed and lost control of the car, nearly hit a bus, went up the footpath, and stopped only centimeters from a shop window. And for a second, everything was quiet in the cab. And then the driver said, "Look, mate, don't ever do that again. You scared the daylights out of me." The passenger apologized and said, "I didn't realize that a little tap would scare you so much." The driver replied, "I'm sorry, it's not really your fault. Today was my first day as a cab driver. I've been driving a hearse for the last 25 years." I have told that one a few times, but I do like it. Now, death and scenes of death are the context for both our Old Testament and our gospel readings this morning. In the first, the prophet Ezekiel is given a vision that represents the sorry state of God's people. Israel had been unrepentant, always a telltale sign in the scriptures that suffering was to follow. They were conquered by the Babylonians and dispersed across the empire. And the prophet gazed out into that valley. The Lord showed him. He saw that it was littered with bones. And these bones are dry, very dry, the scriptures tell us, which means that they have nothing of the power of life in them. And God sees the somber gaze of his prophet and opens the door to possibility with a question. "Mortal, can these bones live? Can these bones live?" That is the question. That is always the question. Can a rescue be worked? Can the people be brought home? Will empires tumble? Will justice and peace finally rule? Can the blind be made to see and the lame to walk? Will there be an end to poverty, despair, and destitution? Will the cycle of drudgery, hopelessness, and cynicism ever come to a halt? Can the dead be made to live? This is also the underlying question in the gospel story. Jesus is met by profound grief before he is even able to arrive at Lazarus' home. Martha meets him on the road. We can almost sense perhaps some anger and regret. "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died." The desperate long to rewrite the past. We mourn not just the loss of a loved one, but of conversations we will no longer have and regretful decisions we made while they were with us. And so much of the time, we wish we could go back in time, do things differently, say what needs to be said, make the right choices, do what we think we ought to have done. But the past is no place for the living. And even in her grief, Martha's regret turns to hope. She says, but even now, I know that God will give you whatever you ask of him. But even now after her brother has been dead 4 days, even now though all had seemed to lose hope, even now something was possible. Then Jesus, again greatly disturbed, came to the tomb. Jesus isn't just feeling compassion for those who are mourning. He is not simply sad. The word used here implies that he is also angry, upset and angry at the effects of the power of death still at work, that power that seeks to end life and possibilities, that festers violence and corrupts beauty, that distorts relationships. But resolved in his mission, Jesus begins to enlist the help of the people that were gathered there with him. And he commands the stone to be removed. And then he turns upward to the heavens to pray. And then with a loud voice he speaks, "Lazarus, come out." And at his word, life emerges. Can these bones live? Ezekiel answers this question that God poses to him and says, "Lord God, you know." And God does indeed know the future of the bones. And God will give an affirmative answer. Yes, God knows. Yes, the bones can live. Yes, newness is possible. And he involves Ezekiel in this work. He is commanded to prophesy to the bones and proclaim God's word to them so that God may bring life to them. And suddenly there was a noise, a rattling, and the bones came together, bone to its bone. I looked, and there were sinews on them, and flesh had come upon them, and skin had covered them, but there was no breath in them. Then he said to me, "Prophesy to the breath, prophesy, mortal, and say to the breath, thus says the Lord God, come from the four winds, O breath, and breathe upon these slain, that they may live." I prophesied as he commanded me, and breath came into them, and they lived and stood on their feet, a vast multitude. That which was dead has been made to live. The people who had been dead in sin, dispersed across the vast empire, are to be made whole again. The hopeless are given hope and the lifeless life. And in this prophetic word, we hear at least four things. First, that it is God and only God who creates new life. Secondly, God uses people, in this case, the speech of the prophet, to bring God's newness and new life. Thirdly, the command of God and the speech of the prophet evoke a resurrection to new life. This is indeed a resurrection event. But lastly, it's also a creation event. And if we were to go back to Genesis chapter 2, we find those similarities. The first humans created, but being without breath, and God breathes God's spirit into them. This is a powerful moment of creation and of recreation, when God's sovereign purpose for life overrides the threat of death. Ezekiel's prophecy was a word for the people of God, dealing with a concrete socio-political situation. They were conquered, they were desperate, they were destitute. And the question posed in this text is whether this powerless people can once again participate in the power of public life, of being a restored and whole community, a nation once again. And the answer to this question is an undeniable yes. Some commentators believe that in the story of the raising of Lazarus, there's also a message being delivered to a people feeling cut off from their communities. John's gospel was written primarily to Jewish Christians who were feeling the sting of stigmatization for turning to Jesus as their Messiah. They were being kicked out of the synagogues, at the center of their religious and social life. They were enduring sneers, scoffs, perhaps even cut off from family, friends. But in this gospel story, in the story of Lazarus, they are being given hope. Lazarus' name actually means God helps. And in this story, we find a powerful resuscitation and new life, not only for Lazarus, but to be shared, in fact, with the entire Christian community. This story that shows that the Lord is not subject to death, but is the Lord indeed of life, brought validation to early Christian hopes and claims that Jesus is indeed Lord. Yet this story also presents the harsh truth that much of the time we do not welcome the new life God wishes to give. As long as today's gospel story was to hear, there's more to the story. Immediately following this story, we do hear of a few folks coming to follow Jesus. But we also hear that it steeled the resolve of Jesus' enemies to plot against him, to plan his demise, and perhaps even the demise of Lazarus. Here in the midst of this incredible miracle, the surprising wonder as Jesus calls Lazarus out of that tomb. Yet how typical that the human response to something that it does not understand is one of violence. One writer put it this way: there is not much rejoicing at the raising of Lazarus. Since the giving of life projects a future full of surprises, it turns out to be a menace to those who think they control the future. They respond the only way they know, with violence. They even plot to do away with Lazarus. But the larger story confirms that life will not be overcome by death. What remains beyond the raising of Lazarus is not only Jesus' death, but his resurrection and his persistent giving of life. We hear this story nearing the end of our Lenten journey to remind us that as we journey with our Lord through his passion, we know that his death is not the end of the story, nor is it the end of ours. But that God continues to birth new life in often surprising ways. And I think we ought to ask ourselves, how do we respond to resurrection surprises? How do we respond to new life? As a church community, as a church family, the noise of children sometimes, signs of life, or do we grumble and complain that these children are too loud? Do we complain or insist on having things our way instead of trying to accommodate those who are not yet part of our church family? Do we become angry and resentful when life circumstances remind us that we are indeed not in control of our lives, as much as we like to think we are? How do we respond to those things, and even those people that we do not know? We know that if we respond negatively, just as we are capable of being used by God to be ministers of life, to offer words of life, we also have the capacity to speak words of death that can hurt and harm and bring people down If you've ever been around people that fight a lot, you know what I speak. Fighting, name-calling, criticism, crankiness, you know, whatever you'll find on the schoolyard. Being around that perpetually, you know, can eat away at you. Both these texts remind us that that is not our calling, but our calling is rather to proclaim words of hope and life. It was Jesus who commanded the dead to come forth, but he also involved the community gathered to participate in this miracle. They rolled away the stone, and they were commanded to unbound Lazarus and loosen him from his grave clothes. And it was God who did the recreating in Ezekiel's vision, but it was Ezekiel who was charged to proclaim God's word. Many in our world, and even in our midst, it feel like dry, dry bones, without hope, without purpose. Many feel entombed in their own feelings of worthlessness, trapped by circumstances beyond their control, paralyzed by grief and fear. And many hear only the death voices that accuse them of failing as parents, of failing as a worker, as a spouse, just failing at life. And there are so many of these voices over and over and over that would bring us down. But what words will we use? And what voices will we listen to? What are the kind of people God is calling us to be? People of resurrection, people of life, and of hope. And so even now in this time, that even as a parish we reel once again in grief, even when we look around us and see the powers of death at work in the world, working against the flourishing of the human family, fanning the flames of prejudice and hate and despair, will we choose to be people of the resurrection? Will we see new possibilities instead of problems? Will we embrace change as evidence that God is continuing to work to bring newness into this world? And can we discern the Lord's voice calling us out of the tombs of sinfulness and despair? I'd invite you to pray with me now. And as we close our eyes, perhaps it would be helpful to picture ourselves in the darkness of that tomb that held young Lazarus. There are many things in our lives that could be that tomb for us. Regret, guilt, despair, feeling trapped, lonely. If you are feeling bound in any way this morning, if you are sensing or feeling a heaviness and a weight that would seem to be paralyzing, hear the Lord of life who speaks to you, who calls you out of the darkness of death into the light of new life. And hear him calling you by name. Lazarus, come out. Stephen, come out. Ron, come out. Sandra, come out. Hear Christ calling you. And may the word of God's resurrection life sustain us and enable us to journey with our Lord, wherever that may take us. Even as we are led closer to the cross, let us cling to hope that our Lord is the Lord of life. Amen.